So friends, this VIDAR test, it is used for the diagnosis of typhoid disease. And all of you know that, typhoid disease, it is a foodborne and waterborne disease. So this disease occurs in our body if we consume the contaminated food material or if we consume the contaminated water or if you drink contaminated water. So that leads to the, this disease here, typhoid disease. And the causative agent of typhoid disease is a gram-negative bacteria that is called as Salmonella typhi. And less commonly, it is caused by the Salmonella paratyphi. So actually, the disease which is caused by Salmonella typhi, it is called as typhoid disease. And the another disease which is caused due to the Salmonella paratyphi A and B, that disease is called as typhoid A and it is known as typhoid B. Okay. So the infection, it is always comes from the another human being. Either he is a ill person or he is a healthy, but he is a carrier of that particular bacterium or pathogen. Okay. And this pathogen, it is transmitted through the ingestion of food as well as any drink that may be the water, for example, which is contaminated by the fecal matter or urine of the infected people. Because this Salmonella typhi, it is present in the fecal matter or in the urine of those persons who are already suffering from typhoid disease. So that fecal matter or stool, it consists of this Salmonella typhi. And if this fecal matter mixed in the municipal water supply or in the foods, then through the flies or cockroaches. So, and if we consume such food material or if we drink that water, so we get infected with this Salmonella typhi. And finally, we get suffer from the typhoid disease. So this bacterium can tolerate both drying conditions as well as the refrigeration. So the next point is here. Just 1 minute. So this is the how that disease is spread in the different in the world here. For example, that is no need. See, this is the Salmonella typhi bacteria. So it is a flagellated. And now this, see, this flagella is present throughout the surface of this bacteria. So that means the flagella is peritrichous in nature. Okay, that means the flagella is peritrichous in nature and it is aerobic, that bacteria is aerobic and it is gram-negative rod-shaped bacteria, that is bacillus. So the shape of that bacteria is, it is like a rod shape. Then, so there is no need of taking this risk factor because we are focusing, mainly focusing on the diagnosis of this typhoid. See, okay, so that's why I am directly jumping on this diagnostic technique, that is the VIDAR test here, or actually these are the different tests which are useful for the diagnosis of typhoid disease. For example, the first one is here, that is detection of antibodies in the serum. If that particular person is suffering from the disease, so if you take the serum or blood and I separated it in the serum, then there is a detection, we will detect antibodies to this typhoid bacillus. And that antibodies that can be detected with the help of this VIDAR test, that may be the tube method or that may be the slide method. And this VIDAR test we are going to see today. Then another test one is here, typhi dot assay, then dipstick assay, then another one is here, Tubex system. So that is the detection of antibodies in serum. If you want to detect that antigens in the serum, just 1 minute, I think there is a net. See the detection of antigens, if you want to detect antigens present in the serum of that patient, then that Tubex system is there, agglutination test is there, ELISA test is there, and there is an immunoelectrophoresis is there. Then how that antigens can be detected in urine sample. So there is a Tubex system, then immunoelectrophoresis is there, latex agglutination technique is there, and coagglutination test is there. Okay, so these are the different techniques here. But today we are mainly focusing on this VIDAR test. So before that, if you see, this is the focusing on this VIDAR test here. So this VIDAR test, see, this is the general structure of that bacteria, or we can say antigenic structure of this Salmonella typhi. Okay, so there is a H antigen is there, that is the flagellar antigen. See here, that is the flagellar antigen. Then O or somatic antigen is here. This is the O side chain or somatic antigen. And VI, that is a virulence capsular polysaccharide antigens are there. So these different types of antigens are present in this Salmonella typhi. So what is this Vidal test? So Vidal, it is one type of antigen antibody reaction. Okay. So what is this Vidal test here? This Vidal, it is a one type of antigen and antibody reaction, and it is a tube as well as slide agglutination test. So what is the name of that antigen antibody reaction? That is the Vidal test. It is called as the agglutination check in the tube as well as on slide. So what this agglutination or Vidal test determines here? It detects the anti-O and anti-H antibodies present in the serum. For example, if that particular person is infected with Salmonella typhi, so that person's body will produce antibodies against this Salmonella antigen, that is antigen O and antigen H. So whatever that antibodies are present in the serum, that antibodies are against, that's why there is an anti is written. So that antibodies are against O and that antibodies are against H. So this Vidal test, it detect the anti-O and anti-H antibodies. So what will be there in Vidal kit? So in Vidal kit, there will be one slide and there are antigen O and antigen H are present. Because when you will take the serum of that patient, so what we will do, you will mix the antigens present in Vidal kit into that sample. So if there is a antibodies are present, which antibodies? Antibodies against this O antigen and antibodies against this H antigen. If they are present in serum, then there is an agglutination reaction will take place and that clumps will be formed here. So that Vidal test can be useful for the diagnosis of typhoid as well as paratyphoid cases. So carriers of this typhoid bacilli, they have antibodies against the VI antigen of Salmonella typhi. And for this reason, the use of VI agglutination for detection of carriers was suggested. Means, because carrier means here, that is the person in whose body that pathogens are present, but he does not show any symptom. Then that person is called as a carrier person. Okay. So you can't observe any symptoms in his body or there are no symptoms. So in such cases, that pathogen, whether that person harbors that pathogen or not, if you want to check, then there is a which technique is used? There is a use of VI agglutination technique. Okay. So this is about the general introduction about Vidal test here. So the next point is, so the next one, so significance, first week negative. Just keep in mind that now. So when, suppose if you, after appearance of infection, for example, and if you go to the doctor, and if that doctor is suggesting to you to conduct to check this pathogen or for prescribe for this Vidal test, for example. So you have to keep in mind if you are doing that Vidal test in the first week, then that Vidal test will be negative. Okay, there is no use of that checking of that your blood sample or your serum with Vidal test in first week of infection. What is the reason? Because the concentration of that antibodies that will be increases in the second week. And at that time only that can be, that antibodies can be detected. Otherwise in first week, there will be no antibodies or that antibodies are very few in your blood, though you are infected. So that test will become, that test shows negative result. So there is no use of that test in the first week. Okay. The next point is here. So the next one. See, this is the typical serological profile after acute infection. So here, these are the concentration of antibodies present in the serum. Okay. So these red, see, these are about the time in weeks. So this is the, suppose in first week here. So up to this year, for example, up to 5 days of after infection, there are no antibodies present in your serum. After 5 days, the antibodies are less, then they get increases here. That is after 1 week. So at that time, that can be detected here. And again, that population will be decreases. And that is of the immunoglobulin M or antibody M. Then the concentration is high after that is of IgG or which is called as immunoglobulin G. So in this way, the concentration of that antibodies will be changed in the serum after the infection. from Salmonella typhi. See, these are the materials or the requirement for the viral test. So the antigens, which antigens are required here? That is suspension of Salmonella typhi O antigen, suspension of Salmonella typhi H antigen, suspension of Salmonella paratyphi A H antigen, then suspension of Salmonella that is Schottmulleri H antigen, and antibodies, that is antibody, where these antibodies are present, that antibodies you have to detect from the patient. So that's why you will require a serum of suspected patient. So you will require the patient's blood, then you will take serum, so that in this way, then you will require normal saline and test tubes and the pipettes, or slide and the pipette. So that slide is provided in the that viral kit also, which is available in market. So here that is that we are going to perform the tube viral test here. So these are the tube numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So what is the purpose of these tubes here? That is to find out the antibody concentration here, or this that is called as the titer, T-I-T-R-E. Titer means concentration. So this is the O antigen, H antigen, then Salmonella paratyphi A antigen, Salmonella paratyphi B antigen. Then you have to shake several times, put it in the 37 degree Celsius water bath for 16 to 18 hours, and let it stand at room temperature overnight. Okay. So next one is the slide and tube agglutination test used in the serodiagnosis of enteric fever. That is nothing but the typhoid. So what will be the your observation here? So see, do not shake tubes before reading the result. Otherwise, that disturbances will be there. So control tube, no agglutination, lowest titer tube means lowest concentration. That is in this way here, or agglutination titer. How will you interpret that? The highest dilution of the serum, which appears bacterial agglutination. So that indicates the, so in this way here. See the O antigen. So that means in this way there is a concentration. There is no reaction is there, or that antigen antibody reaction is there. That reactions are completely absent here. So in this way, so this indicates the higher titer concentration or more concentration. So इस तरह से आपको ये concentration मतलब वहाँ पे find out करना है viral test में, tube test में. So agglutination, how it appears after reactivity. So how that agglutination takes place here? So agglutination, it is the one type of antigen antibody reaction. Okay. So just keep in mind that O antigen, that Felix tube, round bottom, and there is the agglutination takes place. This one H antigen, Dreyer's tube having the conical bottom, and that is specifically for the H agglutination. Then what will be the result? Compact granular agglutination. So there is a granules will be formed in the sample, in the mixture here. Which mixture? That antigens you are adding from the viral kit, which is available in the market, and that serum you are taking from the patient, or that blood taking from the serum and separating serum. So after that, when you will mix both of these, so there is a compact granular agglutination will be there. So compact granules will be formed here, and presence of that compact granules, what it indicates? It indicates that antibodies are present in the patient's serum, which are specific to this O antigen. And occurrence of this compact granular agglutination, so that indicates that person is infected with Salmonella typhi, or he is suffering from typhoid. And then doctor will give treatment according to your result, according to your report. If suppose there is a loose cotton woolly clumps are there, cotton type clumps are there, what it indicates? It indicates that patient serum consists of antibodies which are specific for this H antigen. Okay. So that will indicate again that person is infected with Salmonella typhi, or he is suffering from typhoid disease. So observe for agglutination, H antigen, loose cotton woolly clumps, O antigen, compact fine granular agglutinations or clumps will be there, and supernatant if there is a should be clear. So in this way, that viral test can be done or can be used. See, this is about the O or somatic antigens, that is lipopolysaccharide in the cell wall. These are heat stable, these are less immunogenic, then agglutination with anti-sera, how it takes place? Fine contact granular chalky clumps are formed here, like a powder, chalky powder, like that. Then H antigens present in the flagella. Where that H antigen is present? It is present in flagella. It is heat labile. That means it is sensitive to the heat. Then it is strongly immunogenic. So it induces the immune response very rapidly, and it induces rapid as well as high antibody concentrations, titers. Titers means concentrations. Then agglutination with anti-sera, that is from the taken from the patient. So there is a large loose cotton wool clumps will be formed like this here. And this is the granular. Granular in the sense means here, just I will show the one granular in the sense, that means there is a very small will be there, or small clumps will be there like that. So VI or virulence antigen. So it is a capsular polysaccharide which is expressed on certain types of the Salmonella typhi. It is heat labile, that is sensitive to the heat. Then it is poorly immunogenic, but it produces the antibodies which are protective in nature, or that antibodies protect us from the pathogen or disease. So this detection of VI antibody, these are not helpful in diagnosis. Why? Because these VI antigens, these are generally present in the carrier person. So absence in case of typhoid, that is poor diagnosis, or persistence of VI antibody, that is nothing but the carrier state, as I told now. So that is mainly, these are present in the that persons who are carrier. Carrier in the sense, just they are harboring that particular pathogen, but they does not show any symptom. Okay, and such persons are very dangerous to spread the disease from them to the healthy person. Because what we consider, so that particular XYZ person, they does not have any symptoms. That means what we will think? We will think that he is a healthy person. But actually, he will be a carrier of that pathogen. And when we will come in contact with that person, so we get suffered from the pathogen, or we get suffered from infection like that. So this is the agglutination reaction here. Fine agglutination, polar attachment. So this is just like this here. There is the antigen antibody reaction takes place. And this is for O or somatic antigen. For H or flagellar antigen, see, this is a coarse agglutination, flagellar attachment here. In this way, there is a H antigen agglutination will be takes place here. And the VI or virulence agglutination here, it is a very fine agglutination like this here. So this is the types of agglutination reactions in viral test. So the next one is here, that is when there is an antigen antibody reaction takes place. So there is a one phenomenon occurs, and that phenomenon is called as prozone phenomenon. So what is this prozone effect or phenomenon? So it is generally observed when the concentration of antibody is high, that is lower dilutions, and there is no agglutination, and then as the sample is diluted, agglutination occurs. Because the antibody concentration is high, as compared to that antibody concentration, the concentration of antigen is less. So that's why this effect is called as the prozone effect. Then lack of agglutination in the prozone, it is due to the excess of antibody molecules, which results in the formation of very small complexes. And that's why there is no clumping occurs, or there is no any visible agglutination reaction takes place. Otherwise, visible agglutination means here, you will see the clumps in the reaction mixture. So that is visible agglutination. So what are the limitations of this viral test? So this viral test, it is a time consuming, and often times when diagnosis is reached, it's too late to start an antibiotic regime. So that is time consuming. So that's why sometimes what happens, if you wait for the result of this viral test generally, so that will require, the doctor cannot start the treatment here. Okay. So that is about the tube agglutination test. Viral test, so whatever the plate viral test here, or slide viral test, that will occur in short duration. So in spite of several limitations, many physicians depend on this viral test. So at present also, if you want to diagnose, or if doctor suggest to that patient, for example, to carry out the viral test, so that means doctor also depend on this viral test for the diagnosis of typhoid disease. So in some cases that false positive reactions with the viral test occurs. For example, in which cases patients who had the previous vaccination or infection with Salmonella typhi. Okay, suppose if that person is already infected with Salmonella typhi in suppose few months ago, so what will happen? That patient's body will consist of antibodies against this Salmonella typhi. So at that time, if second time, if you want to perform this viral test, so at that time the antibodies can be detected in that patient, but that antibodies are from previous infection. So that is the false positive reaction. Then cross reaction with non-typhoidal Salmonella. So Salmonella genus, but it does not cause the typhoid. So there is a cross reaction takes place, and in association with some autoimmune diseases also. In some case autoimmune diseases, that viral test gives the positive result, and it also gives the positive with infection with malaria, or that can be limitation, or that cannot be used. Okay, see, this is the slide viral test. As I told you, see, this type of antigens are present here. See, this is the name of company here, that from which that or they will supply viral kits, stand diagnostics. So these are the that small holes are present just like a cavity slide. Okay, this some hollow circles are here to put the sample as well as that viral kits reagent. So in this way, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 or concentration. So in this way, that agglutination reaction will take place here, like this here. See, these are the granules you are looking here. H antigen, H, O, then B, H, N, C. That is a non-negative control, positive control to compare. N, C for negative control, P, C for positive control. B, H means here, that is from the Salmonella paratyphi B, H, Salmonella paratyphi A, H, Salmonella typhi H antigen, Salmonella typhi O antigen. So in this way, that slide test is utilized for the diagnosis of or viral test is utilized for the diagnosis of diseases. So there is a prevention and treatment that is not the part of our test here, or viral test. So this is about the viral test. Now friends, I will stop the sharing of this screen here, but because viral test is completed. Now the next one we will see about the, that is about the now see, the next technique is here, Gill-Nielsen staining technique, or which is nothing but the acid fast staining technique. That is also called as the acid fast staining technique, and it is the technique or the diagnostic technique used for the diagnosis of diagnosis of TB, or for the detection of Mycobacterium tuberculosis in the clinical sample. So we are going to see this, all about this history, principle, then reagents which are required for this test, procedure, then names of acid fast bacteria, importance of Gill-Nielsen staining technique, and different modification of the reagents, and finally errors. So this staining technique, it was first discovered by the Ehrlich in 1881, and that is modified by the Gill and Nielsen. So that's why this staining technique is also called as the Gill-Nielsen staining technique. And it is a differential staining technique used mainly to detect the mycobacteria. Okay. So this acid fast means, so this technique is also called as the acid fast staining technique. So what is the name of this technique here? So that is also called as acid fast staining technique. So why this is called as acid fast staining? So acid fast, that means bacteria which protect the primary dye. Okay. Or the primary dye or stain to be washed off from the action of acid alcohol decolorizer. So though you are using acid alcohol decolorizer, but some bacteria, they protect that particular dye. There is no washing off even there is a use of this decolorizer, which is a strong decolorizer, but there is no effect of this acid alcohol decolorizer on this primary dye. It remains as it is. So that's why it means it is called as the acid fast. And those bacteria resist such action of this acid alcohol decolorizer, that bacteria are called as acid fast bacteria, or AFB. And one of that example is here, Mycobacterium tuberculosis or Mycobacterium leprae. Okay. So what is the principle of this test here? Acid fast staining technique, or that Gill-Nielsen staining technique. So acid fastness has been ascribed to the high content as well as variety of lipid, fatty acids, and higher alcohols which are present in the tubercle bacilli. Because this Mycobacterium tuberculosis, it is, the shape is rod shape, bacilli. And lipid particular to acid fast bacteria is a long chain fatty acids, which is called as the mycolic acid. So this is the characteristics lipid or fatty acid present in Mycobacterium tuberculosis. And acid fast is not a property of lipid alone, but it also depends on the integrity of the cell wall. Okay, see, this is the principle of this acid fast staining. And this is due to the presence of this lipid as well as fatty acid and higher alcohols. So this lipid particular to the acid fast bacilli, it is a long chain fatty acid, and that is called as the mycolic acid. Okay. So this acid fast, it is not property of a lipid alone, but it is, depends on the integrity of the cell wall of that Mycobacterium tuberculosis also. Now the next one is here. See the next component, that is the, see these are the components here that we have seen principle. Then this Gill-Nelson stain, it is a modification of the Ehrlich's original method for the differential staining of the acid fast bacilli. And there is a use of that particular stain or dye, which is called as the aniline gentian violet, which is followed by the strong nitric acid. And the ordinary aniline dye solution, it does not react readily penetrate in the acid fast bacteria or that bacilli. So the use of this powerful staining solution that contains phenol, and there is a continuous application of the heat. So when you are adding that particular stain on the slide on which you have taken the sputum sample, for example, or that bacteria, then you have to continuously heat that slide here. Simultaneously, you have to add the staining solution. Okay. So this phenol will solubilize the cell wall, and that heat or heating of that slide continuously will increase the stain penetration, because actually this stain cannot penetrate here. So that's why there is a continuous heating is done. And once the stain of the tubercle bacilli, they will tolerate or they will withstand the action of powerful decolorizing agent, okay, for the longer time or for considerable time. And that's why it retains the primary stain when there is a, everything else has been decolorized. The remaining material or that cell wall or cell will be decolorized, but that stain will remain as it is. So what are the reagents which are required here in Gill-Nelson staining technique or in acid fast staining? There is a primary dye is required, and that is nothing but the carbol fuchsin, or it may be, that is nothing but the basic fuchsin with phenol. Is it audible and visible? Then second one is here, decolorizer. So there is a use of sulfuric acid, alcohol, as well as that is nothing but the acid alcohol. Then next stain is here, counter stain. So there is a methylene blue or malachite green is used. So the dye, it is basic in nature, and its combination with the mineral acid, it is used as a decolorizer that produces a reddish pink compound that accept or dissolve out of all structures except the acid fast bacteria, or that is this Mycobacterium tuberculosis bacteria. Okay, so this is the composition of this stain, carbol fuchsin stain. Basic fuchsin powder 5 gram, phenol in crystalline form 25 gram, alcohol 95%, 50 ml, and distilled water 500 ml. So what is the procedure to prepare this carbol fuchsin? So dissolve the fuchsin or that basic fuchsin powder in phenol by placing them in a 1 liter flask or a boiling water bath for 5 minutes. Then shake the contents well from time to time, and when the solution is complete, then you have to add this 95% alcohol and then distilled water. So mix properly, filter the mixture before use. So in this way, you will prepare the carbol fuchsin. But now that prepared carbol fuchsin is also available in the market. So decolorizer, that is sulfuric acid 20%. So concentrated sulfuric acid 250 ml. And distilled water 1 ml. So how you will prepare this decolorizer here? So pour the water in a large flask and place the flask in 5 to 8 centimeter cold water in the sink. Okay. Then you have to add acid in 50 ml lots over 10 minutes. Total acid, how much quantity you have to take? 250 ml. Then pouring slowly down the side of the flask into the water. So mix properly, and that mixture will become hot because of this acid. Okay. So alcohol 95%. How it is prepared? Simply ethanol 95% ml, or sometimes that methylated spirit, it is directly taken as a 100 ml. Okay. Then acid alcohol, how it is prepared? Concentrated hydrochloric acid 75 ml, and it is mixed in methylated spirit. Okay. 2425 ml. Okay. So in this way, that decolorizer, or which is nothing but the acid alcohol, is prepared. So this is the counter stain. Methylene blue, how it is prepared? Methylene blue 0.5 gram, glacial acetic acid 0.5 ml, and it is mixed in distilled water having the quantity of 100 ml. So in this way, that methylene blue, or which is called as the counter stain, it is prepared. So what is the procedure here? So what sample you have to take here? That sample will be sputum of the patient. So those person who are suspected to the TB, for example, that sputum sample is taken from the patient, and then that acid fast staining is performed. So how it is performed? Cover a heat fixed dried smear. Okay. Smear of that sputum sample, which is small rectangle of filter paper. Then apply 5 to 7 drops of carbolfoxin stain to the moistened filter paper. So after on that slide, when you will take a sample here, sputum, for example, then you have to add 5 to 7 drops of carbolfoxin. Then slide is intermittently heated from the underneath, from the lower side, you have to heat that slide. Okay. Just by putting on the wire gauze slide, it is put on the wire gauze, and from the lower side, yeah, there is a burner, Bunsen burner is there for the heating of that slide using a spirit lamp, or for example, until fumes arises. So from that slide, when you will add that carbolfoxin, and after heating, that fumes will be occur there. Then care must be taken not to boil the solution or drying of the slide. So both, in both way, you have to take care. So you have to take care that not to boil the solution, and you also take care that slide will not dry. So continuously you have to heat from the lower side, and continuously you have to add the carbolfoxin or that stain here. Then slide is washed in water and decolorized by 20% acid alcohol until the slide is almost colorless or pale pink. So till you have to add that acid alcohol or decolorizer up to that colorless, the slide become colorless or pale pink. Then the smear is then washed and counter stained with the methylene blue. After that, what you have to do? You have to wash that slide, and again you have to add the counter stain, that is methylene blue solution, for 2 minutes. 2 minutes ke liye wahan pe use ho, aapko ye solution wahan pe rakhna hai. Then the slide is washed again and dried. Fir se wash karke aapko ye slide kya karni hai? Dry karni hai. So this, up to this.
Sir.
Number, yes.
Only English, please, sir.
Okay, sorry. So what you have to do here? The slide is washed. So up to this here, the smear is, you have to wash and you have to counter stain by using this methylene blue stain. And that is for 2 minutes. After that, after completion of these 2 minutes, what you have to do? The slide is, you have to wash again with, and again it is dried. Now the next step is here. So the next step. So now after drying, what you have to do? You have to observe that slide under the microscope. And if there is a observation of pink color, that is bacteria, this Mycobacterium tuberculosis, pink color, bacillus bacteria, gram negative. So that will indicate there is a presence of Mycobacterium tuberculosis in the sputum. So that indicates, what it indicates? The sputum of that patient, it consists of Mycobacterium tuberculosis. That means he is infected with Mycobacterium, or he is suffering from TB. See, these are the pink rod shaped bacteria here, which are called as acid fast bacteria. See this one. Okay. So these rod shaped pink color bacteria, that indicates under microscope, that indicates that sputum of the patient, it consists of Mycobacterium tuberculosis. Okay. So there is no need important of the, so what are the importance of this Jean Nielsen stain or acid fast staining? So that is specifically for the Mycobacterium tuberculosis bacilli. So this acid fast staining reaction of mycobacteria along with their characteristic size and shape is the valuable, helpful, or aid in the early detection of the infection of TB or Mycobacterium tuberculosis And it is also useful in the monitoring of the therapy for the mycobacterium disease, that is for the TB disease. Okay. The presence of acid fast bacilli in the sputum and combining with the history of cough, weight loss, or chest radiography, that are the evidences of pulmonary infection or infiltrate. And that is the presumptive evidence for active tuberculosis. So this is the main advantage or importance of this Jean-Nielsen staining technique or this tubercle bacilli. And that technique is still performed in the laboratories for the diagnosis of TB. Okay. So this is the method for the reporting numbers of acid fast bacilli observed in stain preparers. How these are observed or how that report can be given. So number of bacilli observed, zero, then actually there is no grade. 1, 2, 3 or 300 fields under microscope, then positive or negative. Okay, that is for acid fast bacteria, that sputum is positive or negative. Then 1 to 9 or 100 fields here, one times positive. So in this way, that means what it indicates here, 4+ or like this, that indicate that person is more infected. Okay, like that. That result can be given. So acid fast smears, these are also useful in the following response to treatment. Because as according to the number of that bacteria or mycobacterium tuberculosis count, that treatment can be provided to the patient. So that's why it is also useful here. See, this is the, again, there is no need to explain, I already explained here. So this is the same mycobacterium. So here, we have finished this acid fast staining technique. Okay. So here we have finished this acid fast staining technique, and that four diagnostic technique total we have finished. Yesterday we have completed about the enzyme linked immunosorbent assay and radioimmune assay, and today we have completed about the Vidal test and acid fast staining technique or